2 seconds. Welcome everyone to tonight's Wednesday Night Live show. I'm your host, John Tricali, with my co-host for tonight, Tim, Allison, Phil, maybe. And joining us tonight, our good friend, Greg Troutman, who has been very, very, very busy man. You, can I have your frequent flyer miles,
Greg? Oh boy, which airline?
anyone.
Dealer's choice.
whichever one gets me to Europe. Whichever one gets into yours.
I think they all go there, John.
Points-wise, Tim.
I've got enough Delta to get us all to Europe and back first class.
Yeah. So all right, what the hell are we doing here?
And next week, the show will be a broadcast from a cafe in Rome. All four of us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what are you going to do?
Yeah, and also Allison is back with her segment, Tell Me Something Good, where she will be sharing some articles of random acts of kindness. And tonight's article is 6-year-old honored for helping save mom who had a seizure. So I have the link for that. When Allison does that, I will post the link so you guys can go check out that article. And I maybe Tim has some news and advocacy. Tim? No, Tim does not have any news.
I always find something to talk about, John.
Don't worry.
Just because I shake my head no doesn't mean that it's probably a yes.
Yeah, well, Greg's going to take up. I think Greg's going to take up the whole show. And hey, I have something really, very nice to say to you, Greg, because I was talking to a friend of mine who watched a previous show with you on it. And he said, finally, a lawyer that explains things in layman's terms. And that has to be a compliment, correct?
Well, you know, when you're trying a case in front of a jury, you're dealing with 12 or 13 or 14 laymen, and you've got to break it down for them so they understand it. And actually, yeah. In many cases with judges, they're generalists. They don't understand the specific nuances of every issue. You've got to be able to break it down easy.
Well, that's what he was saying. He goes, you know, half the time I listen to lawyers, I'm just shaking my head. I have no freaking clue what they just said.
You just smile and nod.
Yeah, you just smile and nod and then write a check, you know. But but no, he said it was really good to hear someone that actually explains what's going on. So we're always happy to have you on the show. And you're not on an exercise equipment, so that's great. That's
always no. That'll be later this evening. I'm always glad to be here.
Yeah.
And I'll throw in a shameless plug before we get going. Oh. I'm wearing the Vaporized from St. Louis from Matt and Jackie Mankey. Sent me a really, really nice hoodie from their store, Vaporized in St. Louis. So that's what I'm wearing tonight.
Nice. And we will start a show like we always do with Tim telling us how his week went.
I'm exhausted. I'm tired. My brain is I think just on autopilot at this point. I'm not quite sure. I actually had to wake up at 5 o'clock this morning. I didn't have to wake up at 5 o'clock this morning, but you know how sometimes things happen and there's an email that comes in and then you just sort of have this, and I'm talking about a work related email.
Yeah.
I guess this could apply to personal emails as well. But this email comes in, and then you just kind of have this unusually at the wrong time of the day and overwhelming feeling of guilt. And so you're like, I could get up right now and do something about this. But you know what? Maybe I should take the position of just being like a normal human being and being like, you know what? I'll take care of this when I finally have, you know. Now, the big question is why the F was I up at that early in the morning to even check an email? It's true. I do have some some bouts with I don't have insomnia. Let's not get it twisted, y'all. But I do sometimes have issues with sleeping. I just wake up at random hours and then I have a very difficult time shutting the brain down. It's like my brain just kind of like as soon as the eyes open and then the body starts to sit up at like a 90-degree angle, the brain just kind of starts to move and then it just won't shut down on me. So I have to like play a stupid game on the phone or scroll TikTok or something until I'm just completely disgusted with society that I just need to go back to sleep. Anyway, so that's what I did this morning. So I got up, and of course, when that happens, then I trigger two other individuals to think that, it's time to get up. It's time to eat. You know, I mean, we got things to do, places to go, people to see. That's their sort of normal reaction. And then I hate to be the harbinger of bad news, but it's like, no, there's nothing for you. It's too early. And you're thinking to yourself, I really want them to understand what I'm saying, but I know they're not listening. It's going in one floppy ear right out the other floppy ear. So yeah, I woke up at 5 to work on a small little project, and then I did manage to go back to bed. But then I woke up a little too late, and then I felt guilty again. So this was just a really crappy morning all the way around.
Hey, Tim, this will make you feel better. I got home at 5:30 this morning from work.
Yeah, yes. And to the people in the chat, I was involved in HOA happenings today, but not at 5 in the morning. My neighbors can screw entirely all the way off if I have to deal with HOA stuff at 5 in the morning.
I found some white poop on my lawn, Tim.
Yep, I know. Some really upset neighbor was knocking on my door at 5 in the morning because they went outside with a flashlight and found a poop on their lawn from 3 weeks ago. It was horrible.
Wow. If it's white, it's been there a while.
Fertilizer.
Right.
How's your day or week, day and week going, Allie?
Stressful because in my free time, that I don't have, I also am the president of the South Carolina Vapor Association. Yep. And we have a bill, PMTA registry here. So we've been dealing with hiring a lobbyist, and which we finally did last night, got a great lobbyist, having meetings with lobbyists, meetings with other people and other lobbyists, and you know, working full time and trying to fit all this stuff in. Trying to get people together to go up to the Capitol, you know, and all of that stuff. So it's been stressful, but good now that we're all kind of together on it and we're all working, you know, as a team, which is always really beneficial when you're in stressful situations like this. So I've just been dealing with PMTA registry bills and now one in my home state. So, you know, gotta fight it. So that's what we've been doing.
I can see Allie just like waking up in the middle of the night, just screaming FDA.
It's not even the FDA right now. It's Altria that is the phone in my side. But, you know, I have to believe at the end of the day, the good guys win, right? I mean,
that's right. That's right. Like
big tobacco wins. So we're on it.
Yeah, that's right. And our good friend, Mr. Troutman, is back. How is your week going?
Busy, busy, busy. Aside from a regular law practice, I've been dealing with what Allie's been dealing with, multiplied by about 5 or 6.
Because I'm dealing with all of them too now with AVM.
I'm working with groups, and I was on the ground in Alabama last week. I'm in constant communication with Nick in Florida, with the people in Georgia, with Bill in Mississippi, with the Missouri group, the Kansas group now in Michigan. You know, and then the Kentucky bill dropped on Monday.
Hey, by the way, big shout out to Mr. Nick Orlando, everybody. I mean, Jesus.
Oh, yeah.
Back and forth to Tallahassee. I think it's like a 9-hour drive for him. He's been back and forth like 5-6 times now. He is a warrior.
Yes. It's like find Waldo. I get up in the morning. I had to go to my feed to see where Nick is. Where is Nick today?
If the legislators in Florida were smart, they would just kill this bill just to get rid of, not to see Nick anymore.
Yeah, really.
Maybe they like him as much as we do.
You think when he walks into the building, and the general salutation is not you again?
Yeah, this guy.
He is just everywhere. So proud of him, man. He's not going to give up, guys. He's not giving up anytime soon.
That's not an option.
Not an option.
And none of us, and I know everybody is exhausted. They're worn out. They're threadbare. It's been a long fight over how many years, but we are so close.
Yeah.
I mean, I think, and I hope I'm not overly optimistic about this. I just sense that there's been a total change of attitude. And I got that vibe at the Keller-Heckman Symposium, completely different vibe, very energized. TPE was energized. The day I was at Champs a couple weeks ago was energized. And it just seems like the vibe is so different now. And, you know, now I'm hearing that up on Capitol Hill, that the Senate Health Committee is having meetings with stakeholders. My sense is that they're trying to figure out a way to fix the PMTA process before the courts make them do it.
Yep.
That would be smart.
Yep.
Yeah. And I'm having a great week. I was telling everybody at the beginning of the show, I was trying to get back to my walking, and I met up with my 78-year-old lady walking partner the other day, and she was happy to see me. She says I'm her protection for the 2-mile walk. it's been a good week. Just still trying to get used to working nights again, I got home at 5:30. I went straight to bed, and I woke up at 12:30. So I'm refreshed. I'm going to do this show, take a 2-hour nap, and then go back to work. So I'll be good. Timmy,
yes,
you know what part? You know what part of this show this is?
Oh, not this again.
Do you want? I'm giving you music tonight.
I'm sitting here waiting for music. I mean, I can just start to talk if you want me to talk. I'm pretty good at the talking part.
Slow jams.
You know what? I almost feel like I want to change it, but I'm not going to change it. I was going to carry over like why am I thinking of Lou Rawls? Hey!
Dude, music just gets you in this groove, doesn't it? Just kind of takes you in.
Like Luther Vandross or like what's the guy? Not Teddy Pendergrass. There was another guy that had the really deep baritone. Barry White.
Barry White.
That's who it was. Yeah. Exactly. Hey, everybody, and welcome to this week's edition of the Very Deep Voice Wednesday Night Live Show Edition. Welcome. Let's go down the roster. Let's see who all these wonderful people are here for the show. Drum roll, please. Can't hear it on my table, but that's okay. Just imagine in your brain that's what I'm doing, because that's what I'm doing. Hello, Mallory Gates. How are you, dear? Always wonderful to see you here. Miss Mallory Gates in the house. We got the wonderful Michelle Elliott. Phone home. We got Michelle Elliott in the house. Great to see you, Michelle Elliott. We got a trifecta of the ladies. We got Peggy at E6 Source coming in tight right behind Michelle Elliott. How are you, Peggy, at E6 Source? Wonderful to see you. Hi, Allie. How are you? Allie's in the chat. We got Steve Todnum in the house. Great to see you, Mr. Steve Todnum. How are you? Yes, sir. I'm going to be giving you a call after the show. I'm going to be bringing you on as the executive director of the HOA. Ooh. So you can't get out of that role. You were immediately hired, and that's all there is to that. Jason Vapes, guess what he did? Guess what Jason Vapes did?
What did he do?
He made it. He made it. If you look at the chat, he said really, and with a lot of exclamation points, he made it. We got somebody in the Facebook chat that said,
that's Luke.
Is that Luke? Luke?
Yeah, he's on all platforms. Luke's on all the platforms.
He came in like a ninja. He came in nondescript, clandestine-like. I kind of like it. What's up, Luke? Good to see you. Welcome to the show. Who else do we got? Oh, Luke. There. Now, Luke showed up on YouTube. So now we've got him on YouTube.
He's hey, Luke, on all.
Yeah, can you go over to Instagram? And
Yeah,
and
go to IG.
Go to IG. Leave a comment there. Although we still can't see those just yet. But we'll make sure we go over and check. We'll put a like on that comment. Good to see you there, Mr. Luke. It's been a while, Luke. Where have you been, sir? I hope that everything is okay. And we got Redden in the house. What's up, Redden? How are you? Yes, Steve, that job is just rolling with dough. You might just go ahead and quit the daytime job because HOA pays. Or actually, I remember, you have to pay the HOA. That's how that works. Anyway, that's it. That's it for the scrolling fun this evening. We got 15 here with us. Glad you're here. Let's get on with the show.
All right, enough of that music. I want to find a disco and go on over there. It's try some of my John Travolta moves from the 70s. Oh man. All right. I want to start you off, Greg, with a question. Because this is kind of something that my buddy brought up, and I thought it was a good question. And like I said, I was talking to him about you, and he watched your clip, and he was really impressed of the way you explained the law to the layman. But his question was, and here, let me find it here. Say we win everything with the FDA. We forced the FDA's hand, but we still have 15 years of public opinion that sees things different. Is there a PR company that is out there that would even be interested in jumping on board at this point?
PR firms are like lobbyists and lawyers. No, seriously, for the right amount of money, they'll massage anything they can. It's going to take a lot of undoing to fix the damage that's been done.
Right.
And that was one of the messages in the Reagan, I think in the Reagan-Udall report, was about the messaging.
Yeah.
You know, FDA's done more harm than good, because not only is the messaging bad, it's on both sides, because you know, you've had Gottlieb and you had Zeller, you've had even Brian King publicly talk about the benefit as a general proposition that vape products are beneficial. But then their regulatory actions don't match their words.
Right. Yeah. Well, that's what he was bringing up. He was just like, God, it's been, you know, and I even told him it's longer than 15 years, to be honest. It's been longer than 15 years.
Yeah.
But he made a good point. I mean, it's just been so much bad. It's going to take at least another 10 years just to fix what has been damaged already as far as the public's perception on vaping.
Now, I can tell you, from if there's anything that good came out of COVID, it's now the general population has a very negative view of the public health authorities. I've had people to tell me that aren't involved in the vape industry. You know, they're friends of Troy LeBlanc, my client, and we were at a dinner one night, and I was telling them the story about just this was early in the MDO appeals, about just how messed up everything was. And one of them said, you know, if you told me this story before COVID, I wouldn't have believed you. He goes, but after the experiences we've had in COVID, I absolutely think you're probably right.
Yeah.
And I've got to think that he's not the only one who feels that way.
Yeah, I don't. I don't. And I've said it before. I mean, I brought this subject up and I said, you know, and you can twist it into conspiracy theories all you want. I mean, but I certainly think the public in general was not told the entire truth. That you know, a lot of wool pulled over people's eyes, not straight stories, and a lot of information came out after the fact. You know, I mean, you know, I don't want to get into the political conversation, the back and forth over what people believe with regard to it, but I think our eyes were awakened at that point, and it's an instance like that, COVID. All right, vaping is one thing, but when you talk about something like COVID, and you consider the detriment that it caused, and the fear and the panic and everything that was instilled in the people in this country over that, you would think that the first people you would rely on in that case would be your health officials, departments like the FDA. CDC. Thank you very much. I live in a world of acronyms, and now I'm starting to get old, I guess. Anyway, but you would
need starting.
Well, true. But what I'm saying is when it was so disappointing and so wishy-washy and so flip-flop on all of their guidance and the reality of what it was when it was all said and done. And like where we are right now with it, I was like, how can anyone put any levity into any of the commentary coming from the FDA with regards to tobacco harm products and vaping products? I mean, if they're going to go so far with the national population on something like that with COVID, and then we have to sit here and somehow blindly believe what they have to say about vaping. Mm-hmm. You're a fool if you think that.
Right.
The whole problem with in this it's COVID, it's the vax, the vaping stuff, the Alzheimer's drug, the baby food stuff, and all of that. And it's a number of it's all explained by the corruption, and the because you've got that corruption and the politicization of the process. where the agencies now are becoming political arms, because the executive agencies, and see, this is what's so important about some of these Supreme Court cases that are out, especially the Chevron case, the Loper case, is that Congress does very, very vague things when it passes laws, and it gives the agencies carte blanche to interpret them. The Tobacco Control Act, what is meant by appropriate for the protection of public health, is a prime example. And so it's allowing the agencies to be dictated by the executive branch, and whoever's in, whether it's Republicans, Democrats, those agencies are becoming a political arm of whoever's in power. And then you've got the revolving door between the agencies and the regulated parties, so that when the Republicans are in office, the folks leave the regulated parties, come back and populate the agencies. The people that are Democrats leave the agencies, go to the regulated parties, and they flip every 4 years or every 8 years back and forth. It's a revolving door. And so those two factors come into, and this whole COVID thing laid it open. That's the intersection of the political apparatus and the corruption apparatus intersected together at the same time and place. And COVID just happened to bring it to bear. It's been happening for a long, long time. Everybody knew it. Nobody talked about it.
Allie, go ahead, Allie. You're up. I'm sorry. I was
no.
Luke has made it to IG. I have to say
that. He's got it. Did he also do Twitter? Because we can't forget that.
Oh shit! That's right.
So, in your experience and all the places that you've been now, Greg, you've been traveling everywhere and dealing with different people and different shops and different bills and court cases, you know, I mean, what is like the one thing right now that's standing out to you in a positive way, do you think, like that's giving you hope for what comes next?
Well, and just meeting with some of the senators in Alabama last week, their view of FDA, now granted, they were all Republican, they're all, you know, deeply conservative, but their view of the trust of FDA was about that, you know, same as gas station sushi. And so you've got legislators at the state level, you know, the idea of doing something, and especially when I laid out how flawed FDA's process was from the word go. You know, when they said they were going to get no more than 2,500 applications, they got 6.7 million. And one of them laughed and says, that didn't surprise me. And, you know, all the screw ups that FDA did along the way trying to cover their tracks, you know, they were sloppy. Mm-hmm. And we're in the position we're in right now because of the sloppiness and the flim flamming and back and forth. And, you know, we still don't have. And I said to one of them, FDA demands that we show that the flavored products are effective compared to tobacco flavored products, but they've never told us how many smokers that means.
There's a huge gray area. And when you're spending millions upon millions of dollars on testing, you'd like to be precise because you'd like to make sure that you're giving them what they're asking for, so you have a shot, because it's not like the companies are going to give you a refund when you get denied. So it would be great to have an idea of what they're actually looking for.
Well, and, you know, name me one thing. Have you ever taken a test in school that you didn't know how many points you had to have to get an A, to get a B?
Right. Yeah. Right. Or you even have an idea of what was going to be on the test, really.
it's FDA's standard is sort of like they come in and they hand you a blank piece of paper that is supposed to be your test and say, you got to not only guess the questions, but also then give us the answers.
Right. Yes. Yeah.
And you're wrong if you don't guess the right question.
Yeah, I was surprised. The South Carolina bill is primarily sponsored by Republicans, which I thought it blows my mind. And I talked to one of the Democratic majority leaders here in South Carolina, and he just kept saying to me, I can't support big tobacco. I can't side with you. And I said, we're not big tobacco, though. Yeah. And he kept saying bubblegum vapes. And I'm like, I can't tell you. I'm like, so bubblegum vodka is cool. Like these things are fine. Like, kids don't. I'm like, who's that marketed for? And he just was driving me insane. He kept saying, I cannot support big tobacco. And I said, but you're not. I said, you could be the guy who read some of the science I sent you and learned something. That's what you could be, because you could save a lot of lives if you actually did that. Like, I was at the end of my rope. And he says to me, well, you know, RJ Reynolds has been in my office like three times in the last 2 weeks. And I said, but you can't side with big tobacco. Like, I don't understand. Like, the disconnect, you know? Like, I don't, like, somebody got some big checks cut. That's all I think. That's what I think.
Yeah. Well, that's why my friend brought up, you know, the public perception. And that's a big issue. And like he said, it's going to be a good 10, 15 years. Even if we get everything we want from the FDA and the rest, it's going to take a long time to get people to start saying, okay, this is harm reduction.
Yeah, and then a lot of people are going to die in that time. Well, and that's really...
The universe of people we have to convince is a lot smaller than that. We have to convince smokers that that's who we have to convince.
Yeah, that's what I mean, yeah.
And if the people who are not smokers don't like, you know, us and don't have a good perception of us, I'm sorry. We're not targeting you. We're targeting smokers. And just think... You know, you look at what we've done, what this industry has done over the last decade in bringing the smoking rate down. That's in the face of all the resistance that this industry has had. Imagine if that resistance had not been there or been maybe half of what it had been before.
Yep.
Yeah.
Where we would be, we might be right now already well past the point of smokers and vapors have intersected. We probably are getting now down to, we might be now down to 5% adult smoking rate.
And I'm just glad I quit when I did, because as a smoker, I was always looking for an excuse to not quit. So if I had found out or heard through public health that, you know, oh, well, this is just as harmful, I would have been like, oh, just as harmful. Might as well keep smoking. And I never would have even tried it, because it's really hard to quit. And I've failed so many times with so many options that I wouldn't have even given it another thought.
Yeah.
Well, and I'll give credit where credit's due. I don't know if you all have seen the two VTA TV ads they've done.
They're awesome. Awesome.
They are amazing. Mm-hmm. And those are targeted to people who are not vapers. Those are targeted to Joe Public.
Yeah.
You know, and they're really hitting, especially on the cancer moonshot, which to me is a perfect target.
Yeah, that Come On Man video is it's really impactful for sure. I think they did a really great job.
Timmy, before you give Greg your question, say hello to a few of the new people that just joined us, because they're regulars and they're running a little late.
They're not new people. They're not new right now.
They're new now.
That's exactly what I mean. Let's say hi to some of our good friends who are new to the chat. And let's see. Let's go in reverse this time. So I went north.
That'd be smart.
Let's go south north. All right. So coming in hot. Landing hot was Addy the Emoji King Tooney, just chimed in. Good to see you, Mr. Addy Tooney. And we have our wonderful friend Jeffrey Zamora in the house. Good to see you, Mr. Jeffrey Zamora. I don't know. See, do you guys struggle with that? I like to say burrito. All you people who say burrito, shame on you. Burrito.
Burrito, man. Burrito.
Jeffrey Zamora.
I thought it was burrito.
Burrito.
It could be in Kentucky.
Can I get one of those Burritos with some extra sour cream?
Good to see you, Jeffrey. How are you? We got Skip Murray in the house. Skip's here. Hey, look out. It's peanut butter time. Skip Murray in the house. Good to see you, Skip. How are you? I know I am envious of your Wordle success. I just don't have it in me. I don't know what to do. And we got another rolling R in the house. We got Mr. Rifleman in the house. What's up, Rifleman? Good to see you. I think that's it. I think I didn't have to go that far. Did I miss anybody? I think I got it.
Did you get Skip?
I did. Were you not listening to my peanut butter comments?
Yeah, he's on sugar OD right now.
Wow, the sugar is straight to your ear canal.
All right, Timmy, go ahead. All yours.
So I guess, what is your perception of the idea? I mean, granted, you know, we can look at it in black and white and see, you know, what the intent is behind these PMTA registry bills. Obviously, because the federal government, I don't think, can handle it. But my question to you, Greg, is what do you think is the strategy behind this flurry of bills, seemingly unchallenged, you know, not partisan, bipartisan, just kind of coming right down the pike? Do you think it's a tactic at sort of overwhelming the vaping community to sort of levy their position rather than, you know, kind of like the slow trickle from the federal side?
No, I think what it is, and the Barclays financial report from a couple weeks ago, you know, explained the whole story. It's coming down to, we have started affecting the bottom line in a way that gets on the SEC filings of Altria. shareholders start taking notice. The smoking, the adult smoking rate is what, 10.8% right now? Yeah. I think I saw recently. I've said for a long, long time, when the adult smoking rate hits 10%, that's when everything changes, because the tobacco companies are really losing money at that point. I mean, enough that it's hurting, and hurting as in the shareholders are asking questions. Mm-hmm. The NGOs are freaking out because their grant money starts drying up, and it's hard for them, or harder for them to get contributions, because, you know, it's like the dog chasing the car. What happens if the dog catches the car? It's always, you know, we're almost there. We're almost there. Give us more money. Give us more money. And the needle barely moves. Well, the needle's really moved now. And even since COVID, you know, the smoke, adult smoking rate's down for probably 2 or 3 or 4% since COVID hit. You know, to a point that it's going to be down again. It's going to be down well under 10% within the next couple of years. That can't be allowed to happen.
Yeah. I had a couple of friends of mine that actually quit smoking because of the fear of COVID when it first came out, saying that people with that were smokers were highly likely of getting it. So a lot of my friends did switch over to vaping. It did kind of help. They're like, well, they started doing a little research into vaping, and they saw me vaping, and they started asking questions. And I said, hey, it's the best decision I made in my entire life, and I would not go back for anything. I don't care. And yeah, I had a few of my friends. My question for you, Greg, you've been traveling around, been fighting bill after bill in the court, and from in court, out of court. Have you noticed any local media being around asking you or anyone else any questions during this whole process?
No, because a lot of this process, especially in the litigation standpoint, has gone on well above the media. This is well over their heads. Now, if we get before the Supreme Court, we'll start getting national media attention.
You don't feel that getting them involved, would they get involved? I mean, if you were to, I know there's that old trick like, hey, you know, Britney Spears is going to be at this hotel, blah, blah, blah. Would that work with what you are doing? Hey, Greg is going to be over here. We're fighting this issue on vaping. Would there be any media showing up, local or even network?
Probably not. And I found that for the most part, local media are not our friends.
No. It's true. That's true. Allie.
So, in your opinion, so the Chevron, I mean, how long do they have to come back with a response? What is the average time? Is it going to be tomorrow? Can I start planning a vacation?
Well, it won't be tomorrow. The case was argued January 17th. That's one of the big cases this term. Now, the other really big case this term is the Trump ballot case. And then now that they've taken the Trump immunity case, that's going to be argued the week of April 22nd. That seems like a long time. That is quick. And that's the last week they've got arguments this term. The big cases, now that case will get decided quickly because it's a important electioneering issue. The ballot case will be decided anytime. But the other cases, the social media cases that were argued, I think, yesterday, the bump stock case that was argued today, the Loper case, the Chevron case, those likely will not come out till the end of June, which is the last week of the term. June 30th is their last day of the term. And those big cases usually come out the last week to 2 weeks of the term. So we're not going to hear anything in Loper probably till the end of June.
Okay.
Now, what lines up perfectly with these vape cases that are now already there with Magellan and Lotus, and with Logic that's going to soon be filing, and we've heard from a number of sources that FDA is going to seek cert in Triton. So we're going to have the industry and the agency on the same issue, same basically fact pattern, same law, all there at the same time with a very strong circuit split. And it's coming at a time right after the Loper case will have been decided. This could be some of the first administrative law cases the Supreme Court would take up post-Loper.
That's interesting. That's good. That's what we've been kind of waiting for.
There's some subtlety that people that don't do what I do don't see in the Triton decision. In that Judge Oldham, who wrote the opinion, a stellar opinion, by the way, the wild goose chase opinion. Look at his resume. His resume tells you he's being groomed for the Supreme Court. He clerked for Alito. He clerked on the D.C. Circuit. He worked in the White House counsel's office under Bush. He was the Texas Solicitor General. He studied at Harvard. He studied at Oxford. Okay, he's being groomed. I think he was given that opinion because his colleagues in the Fifth Circuit know he's being groomed. The same way Justice Barrett, when she was on the Seventh Circuit, it was obvious she was being groomed for the Supreme Court because she got to get on all the really big, good cases. Oldham's kind of getting that too. And the subtlety that a lot of people might not realize is that having clerked for Alito, well, Justice Alito is north of 70. And if Trump wins and the Republicans win the Senate, I'm going to predict now that you're going to see Alito, Thomas, and Roberts retire. And you know who will replace Alito? Oldham.
That's good.
So the fact that his opinion that he wrote that was such a strong opinion is likely getting ready to be going to the Supreme Court will get noticed.
That's good news. I like that.
Yeah, we need some new voices.
It'd be nice if those voices were in their early 50s, maybe.
Michelle Elliott's got a good question here. Yeah. I'll try to hit that.
Yeah, go ahead, Craig.
If FDA has to file for cert within 90 days of the Triton ruling, which will be April 3rd, they can move for a one-time 30-day extension, get them to May 3rd, which they will do. They do it in all the cases. So that's then going to put Triton's having until the 1st of June to file its response, us to also chime in with industry amicus briefs, and then FDA would have till the middle of June to file a reply. It would get to the court, probably get conferenced. If they decide to take it, we will know probably in July if they take it. By the time the briefs are done, it'll get put on the argument schedule for next fall. It wouldn't be heard till next fall. Probably heard maybe November, December next year, maybe January next year. Again, with a ruling maybe spring, summer 25.
Wow.
But if they take it, they will probably grant stays. They will keep the Triton stay in place and probably grant stays to Logic, Magellan, and Lotus.
Welcome, Mr. Philip. Philip has joined us.
Hello, everyone out there.
I will jump to you if you have a question for Greg before I jump back over to Timmy.
I actually have a friend who is who's formulating a question as we speak. So if we could come back to me, I'm sorry.
Okay,
On behalf of our state advocacy group, I would like to give him another 5 minutes.
Yeah. Copy.
Good to see you, counselor. Sorry, I'm late.
Philip, you yield your time.
Yeah.
Well, we already have a PMP registry law in place here. Basically, it was among the first Oklahoma, Louisiana, and Alabama were the first to start this foolishness. What we're doing right now is waiting to see how well they're going to fund it. So right now they are, there's a bill going through right now in Alabama, not so much for the PMT registry, but for how to fund the already passed bill that is very much like the ones that are hitting all the states right now. So right now they're just, you know, trying to figure out how much money to give the Alcoholic Beverage Control Board to enforce it, which is lovely.
About $0. Go ahead, Timmy.
Yeah, no, I guess when you look at this in totality, I'm just curious, Greg, like what's the likelihood that any of these bills will see their way to fruition, or are we just going to be watching it being kicked the can down the road, so to speak, for a period of time?
Well, it's going to depend on some factors. Which will be largely political. You know, Alabama is sort of in a disadvantage to everybody else because they've already got the registry law. And it's now a matter of funding the mechanism to enforce it. But other states are looking to, and I've heard this, you know, from other state groups, is that the legislators there are saying, well, you know, look at Alabama. They've got a registry already. And we're saying, and our response back to them is, yes, Alabama's got a registry. And here's the pictures of all the stuff that's on the shelves that shouldn't be on the shelves because it's not on the registry. So Alabama is not a good example. It's a bad example.
No, I agree.
And so this is why it's so important. And Alabama comes in sort of with a leg down anyway, because they've already got the registry. So it's a matter of figuring out how to manipulate this. I wouldn't say manipulate it. It's a massage it where it's the least intrusive. And so if we can, for instance, if we can carve out open systems, would be good in a way, would be good. You know, the disposables, and this is what they don't understand. They can say the disposables aren't allowed because they're not on the registry. That's all well and good. First off, the C stores ain't going to stop selling them. We know that. And it's not going to stop the guy who's selling them out of the trunk of his car.
Right.
And by the way, we don't know anything about those, where they came from, what's in them. And, you know, that's the danger of this. And it's politicians, you know, I'll give them the benefit of the doubt. They need to do something good, but because they don't understand what they're doing, but they do it anyway, they cause more problems than we could try to clean up later.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Alabama's in a harder situation because this is likely going to pass the House in Alabama. And what I've told the Alabama folks is you need to concentrate on the Senate as your firewall to try to kill this. And secondarily, with the administrative side,
kill what aspect of the bill? There's already a registry-like bill in place. You're talking about the funding to the various
The funding. And I told the Alabama people there's four things that can happen. Three of them are good or can be good for you. One of them is bad, and the bad one is that this registry funding bill passes as is. In the House, in the Senate, gets signed into law. That's bad. What is a good thing is we could maybe get the House to amend it down to something we can live with, and the Senate approves it. That's at least a partial victory. Or it passes in the House without amendment. We get the Senate to pass a different version of it, and the sides can't iron it out. By the end of the session, it dies. That's good for you. Or we get the Senate to pass a different version and the parties, the sides get together and they iron out the differences with something we can live with. Again, that's a partial victory for you. Mm-hmm. You all, like I said, you all are a leg down anyway because you already got the registry and you're not going to get rid of the registry. I mean, I can tell you, Barbara Drummond is not going to give up on that.
We understand that very well. We're trying to come to some sort of compromise, and let's say up to this point her response to various scenarios has been who is going to keep me in office and who is going to who has more money. And right now there is another fiscal note on the bill as of today. I'm pretty sure they raised the fees for manufacturers and retailers and probably added a few hundred bucks here and there for education, anti-vaping education for youth, I think. But you're not wrong. You said four things. There wasn't a fifth.
No, four things can happen. Three of them are good or potentially good for you. Only one is bad. I like those odds. And you know, I told some of the senators last week, this whole thing about the education program, I go, she means well. It's well intended, but let me tell you from our experience in the industry how this is going to go. And one of the senators finished my sentence. He says, as soon as you start talking about it in school, the kids are going to leave school that day and go out and want to buy vapes.
Yep, we made that
and I go,
point.
Bingo. That is something that you don't want to talk. And we know that because this is exactly what Juul's business model was. Oh, by the way, Altria, who's pushing this, owns Juul.
Not
anymore.
They dumped Juul and bought Enjoy.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. But it's the same. It's the same business model. You know, the last thing you want to do, and he understood. They understood that.
Troutman, you know, who are you talking about at this point? Huh? Are you talking about a state legislature in the Alabama state legislature, someone in the House or the Senate?
The Senate.
Chris?
I can't name names, but we had some really good Senate meetings the other day.
Okay.
We had some really good Senate meetings the other day. And
Greg would make a good mafia guy.
I don't have the Italian blood in me, so
forget about it. Oh.
You know, I'm part German, part Scotch, and part Cherokee.
Hey.
Which explains why I'm on the warpath all the time.
Yeah.
So, Counselor, you're me, and you have a Barbara Drummond, who I'm assuming you know, Barbara Drummond, who sponsored this.
I've never met her, but I've heard I'm going to maybe get to meet her on Zoom.
Well, I have met her, and it seemed that she might be open to discussion and open her mind to what these products are and what they can do for the multitudes. And I haven't seen her since that initial meeting, but I'm hearing various feedback that's, well, not necessarily good about how she's changing her mind and how she's essentially saying, no, I'm not open to listening, you know, to ideas. Granted, some of the ideas I think our state advocacy group presented to her were dumb. Sorry, guys, dumb. But that aside, I do believe that she is.
I'll call them misguided. That's what they were.
No, they're stupid. Anyhow, what I'd like to say is this. I think that as much as I have tried to believe that Barbara is not aware that she is a spokesperson for tobacco companies in this scenario, and that she is standing up in front of the House members talking about how her family members, one had died from tobacco-related cancer, and she associates that with vaping. And I lost my mind during that first hearing. I said, no one is getting cancer from vaping, Representative. And, well, I like to believe that she's just that misinformed, but it's getting harder every day.
Well, but also to the subtlety that there's a subtlety here that some of the people don't get. And I say they don't get it because they're not experienced in this arena, which is fine. We have to be able to go into the Senate. If we want to be taken seriously in the Senate, we have to be able to show them we tried to work this out in the House in good faith. We presented a good faith. I took Drummond's bill after I got back last Wednesday, spent most of Thursday and Friday marking it up, you know, and fix it. And I don't think she understands the industry first off. And I think that was reflected in her original bill. Right. So I really tried to fix it and correct it.
Well, I think it's CBD products that don't even have any sort of PMTA pathway recovered.
She doesn't understand. Ridiculous. She doesn't understand that FDA doesn't even regulate these products. So she's creating an impossibility, which is going to open this up to a lawsuit, on constitutional grounds, which is fine. There's other things that the education element to it is really
right.
Misguided.
They added that, I think, today, I believe. That's the only thing. Today was a closed hearing.
Right.
And but the only addition I saw was something.
We have to be able to show to the senators that we tried to work this out with her. Agreed. And make an effort. Because that was one of the things we had heard last week as well. You know, we talked to Representative Hill last week. You all have had a year to work this out. And the lobbyists are trying to explain, you know, Representative, she won't return my calls, but you know, deaf ears.
Right.
But we have to be able to show we've tried to do something. And I told the group last week after we were done, I go, I'm going to use an old baseball adage here. We're going to come back to her with a proposed amendment. It looks like it's a good pitch. It looks like it's a fat pitch. It'll be good enough that if
is
she
this hypothetical,
at it, huh?
It's just hypothetical.
No. Well, no. I said we're gonna throw her a really good pitch, but not our best pitch. And we're gonna throw her an amendment that we're gonna really flesh out where she's coming from. And I think my amendment did that. My amendment, if she would have swung at it, we could have lived with my amendment because it would have said if you timely were on the market and you timely filed a PMTA, and you're not on the and I put added, and you're not on the FDA import list as of March 1st, 2024, you're good to go. And the import alert was because she told us that, well, I'm after the disposables, not you all. So I put the import alert element in there because guess what? All of these disposables are on the import alert. So if she wanted to get rid of the disposables, she bites at the import alert. And the fact that she didn't bite at it tells me that's not what she's after.
Well, then tell me what she is after, in your opinion.
She's after doing what Altria tells her to do.
Yeah. So she is fully aware of who she represents.
Absolutely. And the amendment that, and see, this is the subtlety that some of the people didn't get, is the amendment that I floated was to flesh out what her intentions are. We know what her intentions are. But it was, but what I said is, I'm going to throw her a pitch that looks like a fat pitch. If she swings at it, we can live with it. And if she, you know, swings at it and misses, and she comes back and craps on it, then we know where her intentions are. And then we go to the Senate with what we want, ignoring her. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yes. Totally. It turns out she is, she is a Democratic state legislator in Alabama, meaning she's a Democrat. So what I'm trying to say is, I think her ulterior motives have been somewhat thinly veiled all along. I have no idea what's going on my camera here, but as it turns out,
Phillips under witness protection program.
Good Lord, yes. Thank God.
The Alabama
Senate request has finally come Alabama. Through.
Hey, that's where they put them all, is in Alabama. We all know that now.
I think if there's anything Barbara Drummond knows about me, it's that I don't mince words, and well, she does, and I don't appreciate that. I went down there. I spoke to her plainly and with sincerity, with frankness. And at the same time, I can understand that we've had a couple of instances where our group has shown some real indecision, and we've pitched some really dumb ideas that I myself thought, well, good Lord, who came up with that? But at the end of the day, what you just said is appropriate, and I think it's very discouraging at the same time. It's good to know where you stand and where your opponent stands and what she wants. And what she wants is to get reelected in a very red state.
Right.
And that's that. It doesn't really matter what area she represents. And the fact that she is willing to work with, whomever is more likely to, let's just say that the fact that money is the end goal of this in her case is, well, discouraging at the very least. But like you said, now we understand where she's coming from and what she wants.
Well, but you also have to understand, I don't know really anything about her other than, I've looked at her picture, where she's from, so forth. I'm suspecting that her constituency is vastly different than the constituencies of other members of that legislature.
Very. But
okay, so she's catering to her constituency, which is what a good politician does.
Well, let's just say I don't exactly know how to put it, but this, we started with a synthetic ban that was passed in the middle of the night during the pandemic. And then this passed, I have to say, it was when everybody was, snoozing, take full responsibility for it. But, we had this, some funding for the registry bill that didn't pass, or at least it didn't pass the Senate, it was sent back to the House for reworking. And I assume that's what we're working on here yet again.
The Senate amendment, actually, I'll tell you right now, Phil, what the Senate amendment will look like. It's going to be basically Bill Wickstrom's Mississippi bill, and it will divide between open and closed system, and it will restrict flavored products, all flavored products, non-tobacco, non-menthol products to adult-only stores. Hmm. And so it would take all of the flavored vapes out of the C stores.
Okay, we have a single female senator from Baldwin County who is yeah, leading the charge to get rid of all vapes essentially, and she's not really discriminating in this case. Her motivations are whoever can give her the bigger edge come re-election. So tell us, what do you do in this case?
This is why
I mean, other than wait and hope.
This is why my very first inclination when I got brought into this was, you read the tea leaves. This is going to pass the House. And I talk to the lobbyists, you know, and she knows a lot more about this than I do on the ground.
A lot of colloquialisms even for a Midwesterner, buddy. Okay, and continue.
She knows the lay of the landscape down there better than I do. And actually, I'm not Midwestern. I'm Mid-South. We're sort of in between. We're a tweener area. And so she knows the playing field a lot better than I do. And so knowing that, I sort of defer to her. And, you know, what do you think? I follow my instincts. And it just so happens my instincts were right about this. My initial instinct was, this is going to pass in the House. So you want to create your firewall in the Senate and try to go win this battle there. Ideally, you kill it there. And either getting the Senate to say no or passing something that is different and not being able to agree on the House kills the bill.
I have one last question. I'm going to shut up. How do you argue against funding the enforcement arm of the state of Alabama to enforce laws that have already been put in place? My question is that. I mean, this is simply a matter of finance.
My argument is sort of, you're putting the cart after the horse. Why didn't you fund it 2 years ago when you created the mechanism? I mean, that's just, you know, makes sense. And quite frankly, I won't mention any names, but there were several senators who we talked to last week who said that this registry bill was not what Representative Drummond represented to them that it was. They voted for it without reading it based on Mahoney representations, and now they've got voters' remorse.
I have a hard time understanding or sympathizing with that sentiment. They didn't read the bill, and we wish we hadn't passed it. Oh, dear.
You have to understand. Okay, this bill was what? 40-something pages? This bill is like 40-something pages. How many 40-something page or longer bills do they have to look at every time? And I can tell you, just up the day
that's
I was
their
up
job, there, though, right?
Well, but here's the problem. Especially in the state.
It's their job.
But
it was pretty convoluted. We had to make cliff notes for ourselves.
Hear me out on this, though. They don't have the huge staffs like they do in Congress to read these bills. How many of those bills do they have every term they've got to look at? And the day we were up there, these people didn't have 5 minutes when they weren't either in a committee meeting or on the floor, because they were constantly people in and out of their office trying to get 5 minutes of their time, 10 minutes of their time. Mm-hmm. When do they read this stuff? You know, this is what you normally would have staff to do. You don't have staff.
That's what I was just going to say. Staff read this stuff and hopefully staff gets it back to them. That's what you're hoping.
But the staff doesn't understand it. Some of this stuff is, you know.
We are in Alabama. You know, if you actually graduated high school, you are really, you know, you have a pretty big advantage over the, you know.
Easy, Phil.
Hey, I mean, I'm not including myself in, you know, the above average. Like, but what I've noticed is that the deeper
I love how Phil put himself above average.
Well, I mean, I think my GED.
No, I know. You.
Yeah,
it does.
I mean,
don't let them bully you.
Well, back then it was just called a GD.
I went to college. I'm going to let Tim throw out his question here. Hey. Hey.
Thank you, counselor. I appreciate your time.
Phil, the two Utes.
You look marvelous. I look like hell, but you look marvelous.
Thank you, counselor.
Well, I guess my question is more an overarching one. You know, with everything that's going on, with all this litigation that's happening and these PMT registry bills, what's your temper for what you think these legislators are really looking for? Do you think that this is just another chess piece to get to some unsaid goal that they would like to get their hands on, for example, you know, taxation or something to that effect. I realize that they could pass a tax bill, and many have. I'm just wondering what your gauge is for what they think they're accomplishing by, you know, sponsoring these bills and putting them forward.
Or it could be like New York, they ban something and then tax it.
Yep.
that's, you know, that they do that. You know, here's the thing. They have to justify their existence up there. And so what's that mean? I was just looking. Today was the last day to file bills in the Senate in Kentucky. Monday was the last day for the House. 828 House bills in Kentucky. And we're not even a huge state, not even as big as Alabama. And 328 Senate bills. Now, most of those will go nowhere. But guess what? They've got to be read.
Yep. Right.
A lot of them will get committee hearings, you know, and so forth. The people got to read them. They don't have the staff like they do in D.C. I mean, look what they do in D.C. They pass an omnibus budget or a bill that is thousands of pages long, and they do it on a couple hours' notice. No one's read it. They've read a summary of it. They've gotten a summary. Whether they've read it or not, it's a different story.
Right.
But they voted up or down without even reading it. And you wonder why our country is so screwed up.
Yeah. I mean, you would think that they would. I mean, if they're going to stand behind these things, that they would really want to understand what it is that they're actually doing. I mean, across the board. I mean, if they want to think that these are just more elements to the idea that, you know, they're protecting kids or the youth or, you know, whatever the case is. I mean, they seem to ignore the number that continues to drop with regard to that. But I still have a very difficult time trying to wrap my head around why they seem to just turn a blind eye to the other side of this argument. And that is that the harm that it will do to people that are looking to transition from smoking into something safer and more enjoyable for that transition, in hopes that they move to a cessation point. But at the same time, just the whole idea of just sort of allowing the back door to the black market to that door to swing wide open. Why don't they seem to have some concern about that? What is their reward in allowing the black market to take hold of something that they could just logically regulate as long as it made sense for everybody involved?
Well, and the reality is every state is dependent upon big tobacco selling cigarettes. Tobacco taxes, how much does that bring in every year?
Mm-hmm.
MSA money, how much does that bring in every year? You look at the states that ban...
Not as much, right?
No, but that's the point. You look at the states that banned flavored e-cigarettes. Those are the ones that were losing the most under the MSA once the funding formula flipped in 2018. You see, like a state like New York starts losing more than $150 million a year in MSA money, not even tobacco taxes. It's even more than that. They're losing that $155 million, I think was what it was that first year of the MSA. Yeah. They can't let that happen. They've got to have that money. Because the reality is, raising taxes on people is, you know, in many places a political non-starter. But if you do something to an industry that you consider a sin industry, alcohol, tobacco, so forth, that's okay. You can get away with that.
Right.
You can't raise the income tax on people. You can't raise the sales tax on people. That's a non-starter.
Yep.
Well, yeah. I mean, it's a touchy subject right now anyway with the current, you know, state of inflation and the increase in prices. I mean, everyone is generally struggling around. I guess what I would say to that, though, is that, you know, when it comes to particular things, even with inflation, even with higher taxes and everything else going on, somehow people find a way to still acquire those things. And so it just still baffles me that, you know, that they're willing to throw any and all of that revenue right out the window and just let it hit the streets, you know, where it'll just recycle through there and then just only further endanger people who, you know, are involved, even the people who are peddling it. You know what I mean?
I'm ready to buy some chickens because I paid $9 for 12 dozen eggs today. $9.
12 dozen eggs or one dozen eggs?
One dozen eggs. One dozen eggs.
I was going to say $9 is not bad for 12 dozen
eggs. The great big brown vegan, like organic, the jumbos, you know, I'm talking about like the ones that kind of look more pterodactyl than chicken.
Me to have two chickens. So I'm thinking about getting two chickens and putting them in the backyard and let them just go about.
I'm allowed to have a whole shitload of chickens. That's a good idea.
Yeah.
Well, first off, you need a rooster and a hen. You need a rooster and a hen if you're going to do that.
Okay.
But I think also you all are saying some of the things you're talking about are based on the assumption that these legislators think about the downstream consequences of what they do. I don't think they do. And I think that's probably why we've got a problem.
Yeah, they don't.
Yeah. They're more worried about their pocketbooks and getting reelected. And that's the bottom line with them.
They're also looking at making sure this year's budget is funded without regard to, this is the short-sightedness of this whole thing. If the politicians would look at both the expense side and the revenue side of the equation of the ledger, because anybody who's ever had accounting knows you got to look at both sides. Both sides matter. Yes, they're losing revenue. They're losing money on the revenue side because of vapes, but they're saving money and actually more money on the expense side with the healthcare costs they're not having to pay. Tobacco is a really bad bet for states. It always has been. For a long, long time, it has been. Because states spend far more in the healthcare costs for tobacco-related illnesses than they ever bring in taxes and MSA money.
That is something we in Alabama did not spend nearly enough time harping on. That is a point that we should have driven home every day. And I do not have a clue as to why that wasn't happening. But yes, that is something that is so very relevant, so important. Let's just say if you want to talk dollars and cents, that's a way to discuss it.
Really. Yeah. And the reason why that discussion is not happening is because those expenses are not seen in the current term. Those expenses are in the far term.
Yeah.
They don't believe that they're not as harmful. A lot of these people I've been talking to really don't think that they think they're just as bad.
Yeah.
Right.
Public perception. Before we jump into Ali's segment, fun question for you, and I don't think we've ever asked you this one. The first poster that was on your wall as a teenager, Greg.
I know this one.
It was not Farrah Fawcett.
No, hell no. You're a man of taste.
Blasphemy.
We're fine.
Well, you have to remember, I'm a huge baseball fan. And I came of age during the Big Red Machine era, because I live less than 100 miles from Cincinnati.
Yeah.
The first poster on my wall in my bedroom, actually, they both went up at the same time, was a Hall of Fame catcher who shares the same birthday with me named Johnny Bench. And the second poster that went up was a poster of the Beatles.
Oh, all right.
The Beatles I knew. I think I wished you happy birthday once and sent you a virtual Stone song, my bad. And Johnny Bench. I still have a huge baseball card collection from when I was a kid. Hopefully it's still intact and in the wrapper and everything. Otherwise it's, well, worth even less than it already is. The baseball card market, I think.
He retired in 83. He retired in 83. That tells you how long ago this was, 41 years now.
Yeah.
When he announced he was retiring mid-season, the last game, they did Johnny Bench night in like September, late in the season on a Saturday night. And my family was there. And so I got to see Johnny Bench hit his last home run as a major leaguer on Johnny Bench night.
Yeah.
And we went back the next week just to watch the game, just in case he got in as a pinch hitter. And his last at bat in the major leagues, he got up in the ninth inning and hit a laser down the third baseline about 2 feet off the ground for a game-winning double.
Wow.
In his last major league at bat, his last major league hit. So I got to see his last home run and his last major league hit.
Very cool.
I've always been an admirer of his. You don't have to be, let's just say you don't have to live in Cincinnati to be a Bench fan. And he's a legend.
I mean, I count myself blessed of having grown up in that era because I got to see, look at the greats I got to see on the same team. Bench, Morgan, Perez, Foster, Rose, Concepcion.
Yeah, I got to watch your Reds at the World Series sweep my Oakland A's. Thank you very much.
I was at game one in Cincinnati.
Game four.
I was at game one in Cincinnati, camped out overnight the Friday night of the last Pittsburgh National League Championship Series game, camped out in the rain overnight because they'd announced that they were going to have a limited number of tickets come open that had been, I don't know, they've been media seats or whatever. They were the lower level in the right field. So I was right down with a bullpen. And when Rob Dibble went down to warm up in the eighth inning, you could just hear that whap, whap, whap. And he came in and he threw up. He faced Henderson, both Hendersons, Ricky Henderson.
Ricky,
and,
yeah.
And who was the other Henderson that was so good? He played for Boston. He's one who hit the home run off Moore, Donnie Moore.
I couldn't remember that. It's too far ago.
I'm sorry. It wasn't Dave Henderson. No, it was Ricky Henderson. He faced Ricky Henderson, Canseco, and McGuire.
And McGuire, yeah.
So he faced the heart of their lineup.
Canseco. That card isn't worth anything anymore.
And Dibble came in, and he threw a ball 100-plus miles an hour on the inside corner, and Henderson just double-taked and looked back at the catcher like he didn't see it.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. How am I going to hit this?
All I remember is Ace fans taking brooms to the game. I'm like, what kind of freaking fans are you when you're taking brooms to the freaking stadium?
The ones that don't win very often. Ricky Henderson was a mean son of a bitch, too. So, right on. Yeah.
We are going to jump into Allie's segment, and let me give Allie her bumper real quick. Yeah. Tell me something good. Tell me that you love me. Real quick, the article that Allie is going to talk about is in the chat. So if you want to read it after Allie talks about it, guys.
All right. So a 6-year-old is being honored for helping save mom who had a seizure. So a 6-year-old being honored, she ran to get help when her mother collapsed at home while experiencing a seizure. Conover, North Carolina, Mayor Kyle J. Heyman recognized February 5th as Quinn Hill Day and presented the first grader with a certificate of recognition during a city council ceremony last Monday. We are honored to recognize her and her family Monday night at the Conover Council City Council meeting, where we adopted Resolution 524, naming February 5th, 2024 as Quinn Hill Day. Heyman told Good Morning America in an emailed statement, "The young lady had the wherewithal to recognize the emergency, take her younger brother by the hand, leave her home, and seek help from the neighbors that she knew and trusted." Jennifer Hill, Quinn's mother, told GMA that on January 10th, the last thing she recalled was that she was at home preparing dinner for Quinn and her younger brother. She said the 6-year-old daughter later told her what happened. Quinn told me that I actually sat down in the chair that I'm sitting in right now, looked up at the ceiling, and started breathing weird. She fell out of the chair onto her left side, and her body started convulsing. My eyes were open. She kept saying, "Mommy, mommy," and I would not respond. We were shaking, and her hands were together. Her eyes were open, and she was looking straight up, the 6-year-old said, saying the incident unfolded quickly and left her feeling scared. This is the first time that she ever left home without us, the mom of three said. She even told us that she looked both ways before crossing the street, but they went to the neighbor's home and they were not home. So after that, they went to the next home. The neighbor was home and responded to the home with the children. The neighbor returned with Quinn and the brother after seeing the mother, called Hill's husband and the children's father, police Lieutenant Jason Hill, who dispatched emergency medical services to their home. She had a grand mal seizure, known as a tonic-clonic seizure. Say that five times fast.
Timmy.
It's the type of seizure that affects both sides of the brain. causes seizures can vary. So basically, they've always spoken to their children about emergencies, but normally it's a fire or a tornado. So now my iPhone's set up to recognize her face and will automatically unlock in an event she needs to call 911.
That is beautiful.
Bravo.
Well done. Yes.
I've never heard a grand mal seizure called a tonic clonic seizure, but you know, not to make light of people who suffer with seizures, but I think I might prefer calling it by the other name, than Grand Mall. I don't know. There just seems like there's something more.
If you have to call 911, let's just go with Grand Mall.
I got a tonic-clonic there. I got a tonic-clonic.
Hold on. What is the name of the honey? No. Yeah, that's difficult. I've had friends that have epilepsy.
If you say tonic-clonic to a 911 operator, they're going to ask you what bar you're at.
Exactly.
Yeah, sounds like the alcoholic version of, you know, the Klondike bar. It's a tonic-clonic Klondike bar. Say that once.
Well,
now you've got the Klondike bar theme in my head.
Yeah, really.
I have no idea what that sounds like.
A tonic Klondike bar.
Yeah, there you go.
It's not Give Me a Break. Which one is that? That's Kit Kat, right?
No, Kit Kat, you got to break off a piece of that. Kit Kat.
Oh, that's the home.
What would you do for a Klondike bar?
Yeah. That's right. Okay.
Anyway,
where the hell is a polar bear coming from?
They might also think you're saying Michael on it.
Well,
all right, Philip, counselor, please.
To Philip's question, the reason the polar bear comes into play is because they refer to the Klondike bar as it comes from the Klondike Mountains. Whether or not polar bears actually live in the Klondike Mountains, I'm not certain there. But somehow by the power of marketing, they've somehow associated polar bears to the Klondike Mountains.
I have actually no idea how many states the Klondike Mountains
I'm not sure. And if you say states, then I would say there's probably no polar bears there, because I don't think polar bears.
No, they're not. I mean,
they're not indigenous to the United States. Real quick, just side story. It's funny that we were talking about grand mal seizures. I had a dog who was epileptic, and he used to have grand mal seizures. And so I completely empathize with someone witnessing that and going through that. You don't know what to do. It's very distressing. And you're watching something basically run a marathon in about a 2 to 3 minute time period, and it's the most distressing thing you'll ever experience in your life, because you just feel totally helpless.
That happened to your dog. What kind of dog was it, if you don't mind my asking?
I will be glad to tell you. He was a pup. I got him from the SPCA in California. His name was Buster, and he was a 90-pound American black and tan coon hound.
Cool. Our chocolate Labrador Truffle. My father used to like to feed him the rinds from the large chunk of Jarlsberg cheese. As it turns out, that's a big bad no-no for the dog, and it can indeed induce seizures. It's not processed. Anyhow, Truffle was a great big fat, you know, flower bed loving chocolate lab, I think most are. Anyway, when Truffle went down, we were like, oh dear God, get out of the way.
You went to cheese heaven.
No. Oh, three of us, my two brothers, we were so little. Anyway, my middle brother and I and my father had to pick this dog up because it was like just dead weight, and put it in the back of his car. And halfway on the way to whatever vet we were screaming and yelling at, Truffle just kind of starts looking around like, road trip, sweet. And it was, he's like, you feed the dog cheese rinds how many times a day? Stop doing that. And yes, so there it was. But it is scary. It is really scary.
I'm trying to answer the question for a rifleman in the meantime. So if I look distracted, I'm confirming whether or not the Klondike Mountains extend.
Are you Googling it? You're Googling it.
I thought it was New York. No,
it's on the western side of the United States.
Well, it's there Canada. You go.
I think Maine too, doesn't it reach out into Maine? See, I'm trying to find now too.
I keep thinking Montreal, but that's not right. I don't think.
Look, you're located along the Yukon River in the subarctic region of Northwest Canada.
Oh, we're talking Hudson. Damn, polar bears.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right on.
We are a well-rounded educational show.
Yeah. We touch on all. Forgive me, everybody, but I know this isn't a vague question for Greg, but I know Greg is a huge sports fan. So I just have one. Bear with me out there in chat, because I would like to get Greg's opinion on this. But Kathleen Clark getting the NCAA women's scoring title and now going after Pete's record. What are your thoughts on that? I want to get Greg's thoughts on it.
First off, I'm a huge advocate for women in sports. Yeah. Title IX was one of the best things that ever happened. And the fact that she's doing this does nothing but bring great attention to women's sports. You know, the one thing I will be honest about, though, is comparing apples to oranges. It's sort of like the old question, do you put an asterisk next to Roger Maris's home run total? She's done this in an era of the three-point line.
Yeah.
And Pete Maravich didn't have a three-point line.
Yeah.
And Pete Maravich also was not eligible his freshman year.
Yeah, they didn't play freshmen, yeah.
Sorry, that's I have to say this. One of the most underrated baseball movies ever made was directed, I believe, by Billy Crystal, and it's called 61, and it's about the relationship between Roger Maris and Willie Mays. Excuse me, not Willie Mays. Oh, my God. What am I thinking? I'm thinking Mickey Mantle. Right.
Mickey Mantle. So
great movie. Barry Pepper played Maris.
Roger Maris. He's
did
so
a great
good.
Job of it. Did a great job of it. I'm all for it. And if you watched, I about had another heart attack last night at the end of the Kentucky-Mississippi State game. If you watched the last minute of the game, Reed Sheppard hit with 0.2 seconds left, hit a game-winning runner in the lane. This is after he had made a three-pointer, a runner, a layup, and a foul with the free throw. Four consecutive free throws, had blocked a shot, a three-pointer on the corner, and just ridiculous his elevation to block it, and then stole the inbounds pass with 0.2 seconds to go. That was the last minute of the game.
That's working it right there, man.
This kid had 12 points with 12 minutes to go in the game. He ended up with 32.
Yeah. All right, no more sports will piss people off, but I had to ask you that question. I wanted to get your opinion on that. I think she's awesome, and you're right. She's done a lot for basketball, for women's basketball, and I can't wait to see her go into the WNBA and see maybe hopefully see some crowds in the stands to see her play.
Well, women's basketball news finds me, that means it's a big deal because I don't even take an interest in men's basketball, really.
And truthfully, there are some women's programs, they draw more than they do for the men's.
Yes,
games.
They do. Yeah, Iowa, if it wasn't for her, there wouldn't be those butts in those seats in Iowa. There would not be their butts in it. And she's filling stadiums all over the country, which is awesome.
Was a time many years ago that University of Tennessee, you know, the lady volunteers would have more people attend their games than the men did.
Yeah.
That's the Southeastern Conference this was happening in.
There are a couple of Southeastern Conference teams. I want to say Vandy, LSU. Maybe.
LSU. LSU. And actually, LSU, one of their best players, is a really cute little girl who played 3 years at Louisville. And like this last year.
She transferred,
Yeah, I forgot her last name. It's a hyphenated name or part of a van something. Really cute little girl. But the Louisville team, the Louisville women's team, have drawn better than the Louisville men's team this year.
Yeah.
Women's college basketball has always been strong in terms of following. I would say that I don't know. I would say that for quite a while, I don't know if this still holds true, but I think that the collegiate sport is – every bit as popular as the professional sport, if not more so, just on an average. But I don't know. Is the WNBA
they're on the brink of being eliminated if it weren't for the NBA funding them. But I'm going to let Allie talk to Craig about a non-sports question. Sorry, everybody out there. I just know that Greg is a huge sports fan, so I wanted to get his take on that.
I don't know. My question is, I think, what do you think is next? What do you think is going to be like the next big thing? And do you think that there's enough time to make a difference before the FDA supposedly is going to be done with PMTA submissions by June? Do you think there's enough time to do something before they start issuing MDOs left and right?
Well, first off, I don't think that they're going to be done by June. I just don't.
No, they won't be, but that's what there's.
And you know, a lot of it's going to depend on what happens with the Supreme Court. If the Supreme Court grants cert, I imagine FDA is going to stop issuing MDOs. Because what's going to happen is if the Supreme Court grants cert, FDA issues an MDO, someone's going to run right into court, in the appellate courts. They will get a quick stay and ask it be held in abeyance. You know, that's the danger that FDA faces with the Triton decision. If that becomes the law of the land, And I can't help but think that the Supreme Court justices wouldn't be sitting back saying, wait a second, when they read Judge Oldham's opinion, and he laid out in detail mm-hmm. the timeline and how all this happened. I think they're going to see, I mean, Gorsuch, I think, sits back, and I think Kavanaugh sits back, and Barrett sits back, and Alito sits back, and Thomas sits back, and they say, wait a second. This is an agency run amok.
Yeah.
And this is exactly why this is why I think the timing is perfect. The facts of this case are perfectly aligned for being post Chevron. Is that this is exactly what we meant when we said in Loper that we're not going to allow deference. This is an exact example where deference shouldn't be given.
Agreed.
And so to answer your question more directly, Ali, it's going to be a lot of balls in the air at the same time. You've got this Altria stuff we've got to deal with. You know, how is Congress going to react to Triton? Is Congress going to get out in front of this and fix the problem before the courts force them to? Because think about this realistically. If the Supreme Court takes cert in one or more of these cases, they take more than one, probably combine them, and they say, FDA, you violated the Administrative Procedure Act by not doing notice and comment rulemaking on what was a tobacco product standard, the de facto flavor ban. How long will it take for FDA to go through the rulemaking process? At least 2 years.
Yeah.
So that means they're not going to be able to regulate anything for a 2-year period. It creates a vacuum. Congress would be well advised to get out in front of this now, fix this before it becomes an even bigger problem. Now, the beauty of it is we'll get to have a seat with Congress. We didn't have a seat at the table. This industry did not have a seat at the table in 2009 when the TCA was adopted.
Yep.
FDA ignored everybody, and we weren't nearly as strong and savvy today as in 2014 when the deeming rule came out as we are today. We will have a definite seat at the table if there's a new process that comes out of Congress.
Yeah.
And what ideally what we want is legislation that is not vague, that is specific enough as far as what testing looks like, that it leaves FDA as little discretion as possible.
Yeah, fair and clear. That's what we need.
Which is mm-hmm. why we want the states to keep their rights to do as they please instead of deferring to the FDA.
Well, and you know, there's a subtlety and also in what I'm proposing to Philip is, and some of the arguments I made last week is, why do you want to predicate something on how the FDA process is now when very likely that process is going to be 180 degrees different a year from now?
Yeah.
To come back and redo this.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, a year from now, point. 5 years from now, it is.
No, I said, if you're going to do something, don't predicate it upon how FDA is regulating this. And that's where the anti-FDA sentiment really, I think we have an advantage there. That's a good thing.
Hold on, Tim. What were you going to say, Tim?
Well, he brings up a very good question, right? You know, obviously, you know, you're not, why are you going to predicate it on the previous process or the process that was in play at the time if they're going to rewrite it differently to the point where it more generally applies to the products that they're reviewing instead of holding them to a similar standard that they do a horrible job at quantifying anyway. We don't get to hear the reason as to why these MDOs go out, but do you think, Greg, that they might even entertain that even from their particular viewpoint as another way to rake in a bucket load more money from a bunch of people who already dumped the bank trying to get their products onto the market legally in the first place?
Well, and that's why I'm not a big fan of predicating this on the PMTA process. And I say it in a nicer way to the legislators is, why predicate your standard upon something that is proven to be at least a steaming pile of dung? I put it in a
lot. That was your like sweetheart revamp.
No, this is with you. I can talk to you guys differently than I talk to legislators.
Yeah.
Counsel, can you approach the bench, please? Counsel,
I've given you no permission.
Right. But why do you predicate what you're going to do in your state upon a system that is so flawed that the federal courts are saying no to it. That's not a good, but also there's another subtlety too. And this really, really works in the red states like Alabama. This would work great in Texas or Florida, is do what we want to do. Disconnect this from the PMTA, process, and create your own approval process that is not predicated upon anything FDA is doing. It is a giant middle finger to the federal government, and the states are invoking their 10th Amendment rights to recognize the harm reduction potential, and that we've got a 10th Amendment interest in preserving the health of our citizens. And you're interfering with your bad policies, FDA, are interfering with our legitimate interest.
Mm-hmm. So you're saying the states should create their own product review process?
That would be great if they would do that, but they, I mean,
but if it's a review process that we as an industry write, and to ensure that our folks are going to clear it.
Right.
I would be happy to go out there and educate.
I mean, just model it after how it is in the UK, how they do their applications and science.
Actually, very good.
One of the things that Representative Drummond's legislative assistant was asking for yesterday was something, a parameter about testing the products. And so I said to the lobbyist, I go, well, what kind of testing is he talking about? You know,
our lobbyist.
Yes. Oh. And I go, what kind of testing is he talking about? Because are we talking HPHC testing? Are we talking, you know, shelf stability testing? You know, what exactly are they wanting to test? They need to tell us if they want to put language help with language, they need to tell us what we're looking at.
Right.
I can't read their minds. And I don't think they know themselves.
100% they don't.
It would be nice when they do that testing, they actually have the manufacturer there to kind of help them through it. That would be nice. I mean, instead of taking a coil that is rated at 50 watts and pushing it to 150 watts. And
no juice in it?
Yeah, no juice in it. Yeah. Oh, look, cotton burns. Wow, really? Yeah, I had no idea.
This was yesterday.
Well, and you know.
Little children at play.
They don't know what they don't, for the most part, they don't know what they're regulating, but it doesn't stop them. And it's not going to stop them. Our job is we've got to help educate them, and we've got to help corral this. And it may mean we get some bad bills. It may mean some things that not 100% what we want get passed. But if we, you know, try to minimize minimizing the damage is really what we need to be doing at this point. If we can kill it outright, great. You know, this is where Alabama is sort of behind the eight ball. There we go. Actually, Pauly was my favorite character.
Alabama is behind the eight ball. Louisiana is behind the eight ball. Oklahoma is most definitely behind the eight ball because they're adding, you know, new standards to the FDA standards after, you know, you get your product authorized. And the Oklahoma has an additional set of standards, which I'm sure have something to do with getting paid anyhow.
You know, there's a way around, there's a workaround in Oklahoma that no one has really looked at yet. There's a 2019 Supreme Court decision, McGirt versus Oklahoma, that says that the eastern two-thirds of Oklahoma is sovereign Indian territory per treaties going back to the 1800s that had never been rescinded by Congress. The industry needs to make deals with the tribes. If they make deals with the tribes, like for taxes, licensing, whatnot, reasonable, something we negotiate. Because the tribes want money. The tribes want to put, the tribes are, after this McGirt ruling, a lot of the tribal people stopped paying license fees and registration fees on their vehicles to the state of Oklahoma. Well, as soon as, that's fine, well, as long as they're on Indian land, as soon as they drive off the Indian land, the state police have started impounding cars. Yeah. So the tribes are pissed at the state.
Are you ready to argue that we should push this into the casino level of, you know, we need to go ahead and have this right off the docks or on the reservations?
No.
As opposed, we still sell cigarettes in this country, like everywhere. I'm not ready to make that argument.
We go make a deal with the tribes. Look, we'll offer you so much as a licensing fee or so much in taxes. We negotiate something reasonable we can live with. From you, we want the authority to sell these products on sovereign Indian land. So you could still operate your standalone vape shop, but you've got the Indian nation protecting you. And the state of Oklahoma at that point, you're flipping the bird at the state of Oklahoma because they got no jurisdiction over you under the McGirt case.
Who doesn't love to do that? Scorsese has a new film out. You should check it out. It's on Apple TV Plus. Anyhow,
Steve's got a question right there. Have any FDA employees testified against the FDA?
Former FDA employees.
Former.
Well, other than to the Reagan-Udall Foundation, no. But this is why I think if we can get a congressional hearing, and this is one of the things I was talking to one of the other advocacy heads about that was going to be going into a meeting with the Senate Health Committee, is do we want to measure and see what the likelihood that Trump wins in November and that the Republicans take Congress in November? And do we want to look at the possibility of that? And would we get a better deal by waiting? Or do we want to start running something now in the House that's our legislation in the House, maybe get a House committee hearing because the Republicans would control it. So it would be our people. They could bring in the former FDA people to testify. We could bring in Dave Gerlitz. We could bring in the scientists, Abigail Friedman. We could bring in Mike Pesco. We could bring in some of these heavy hitters. That it's going to be, instead of a, paved mom and campaign dog and pony show, it's our folks.
I don't know about Pesco, but I'm with you other than that.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, I really don't think that there's anything. Okay. Yeah. Predicating on this one, you're telling people not to predicate what they do in state courts, thinking about what's going to happen with the FDA in a year from now. Let's just say that the vapor industry shouldn't expect, Donald Trump to swoop in November and save any industry. You should probably go with the numbers, which says that's not going to happen. The other thing is I really am interested in, let's just say any and all possibilities. I'm not ready to go there yet. Like you said, finding new and interesting territory in the U.S. that's not technically part of the U.S. These are safer alternatives to cigarettes. And we need to remind people that. I'm not ready to go ahead and let the public have a look at how we are really, we're hitting the Zuni reservation for our next vape shop because we can't operate anywhere else. That is really a poor look in terms of public perception. Do you not agree?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And, we've got to do that. We've got to do everything we can at this point to increase the public perception about the product. So this is store owners got to be responsible. Store owners got to step up. Don't be doing stupid stuff.
We have Scott Gottlieb, the former FDA commissioner, on Twitter yesterday, basically quote tweeting David Clement's op-ed on nicotine pouches. This is all very good. We have everybody in the world, people who are progressives, conservatives, looking at the FDA, looking at Chuck Schumer like they have, like they're hallucinating, and nobody actually wants to be part of this hallucination. So I think it's some of these suggestions are a little desperate, and they smell that way. So
Chuck Schumer did one of the biggest favors he could ever do for us with taking on Zen.
Yeah.
Oh, I enjoyed that.
Because he didn't do his homework on that one.
Well, because it brought out people that I never in a million years would have thought Senator Tommy Tuberville would come out in support of harm reduction. He took on, Schumer on that. Mm-hmm. It brought out people that I never thought we would have maybe. And what it tells me is, the number of heads we have to get legislation passed is smaller.
As a matter of fact, Tuberville was on Vape Radio a million years ago with Rod, the Rod Man, and he did make a promise to protect adult, consumer freedom in terms of vaping products. And if you want to remind him of that, feel free.
Oh, absolutely. But what it tells me from a political standpoint, politics in legislative politics is a game of head counting. How many people are on my side? How many people are on the other side? And how many people from that side can I get over here and keep from my side going over there? That's if you've ever seen House of Cards, that's what politics is.
Yeah. The U.S. or the UK version?
And
seriously,
I like the UK version better because I love it when they sit there and taunt each other and boo and hiss and I wish we did that in Congress.
USA, USA.
Ian Richardson's one of the great series of all time.
In Britain, they taunt the person who's up there speaking. So if Nancy Pelosi's speaking, they would just pillory her. You're drunk. you know, sober up.
No, British parliamentary procedure is like literally, it's brutal and witty and gorgeous.
It's blood sport. Nobody. It's blood sport. But, well, you know, it works. Getting back to topic, you know, this thing with Zen, I was encouraged because it tells me the number of heads that we have to bring over to our side is less than what I thought before.
It just shows you how fast people are are eager to jump up and say, oh, no, no, when it's something they use. It blows my mind.
The second best thing.
You can take this, but I use this, so you can't.
Yeah, absolutely. The Juul marketing denial order was the other thing that happened that was really
people were like, wait, they're banning Juul? I was like, wait, where the hell have you been?
Even the New York Times wrote about that and saying, where are we going to get our Juul pods from? Right. Because, well, guess what? Everybody has their own gauge of what is and what is not newsworthy or what they're going to get up in arms about or what they're going to testify about.
Yeah.
I just think that we need to keep it in the U.S. of A. We need to keep educating people as to why these products are not only important, they are vital.
Now, talking about Juul, that came out in late June of 22. Juul filed its appeal in the D.C. Circuit, and it pointed out in its stay motion all the things that FDA said in its MDO that Juul hadn't done, and it pointed out all the things that it had done, FDA hadn't bothered to review it. You know how quickly FDA put that back in review?
Mm-hmm.
You know how many 90-day status reports they've had to file with the court saying, we're still looking at this. We're still looking at this. We're still looking at this.
Yeah. No, they say they lost a couple hundred pages of, harmful chemical testing results, all that kind of stuff. And they went in there. They never submitted it. And Juul at the time was like, boom, they're right here. Next thing you know, they have a stay. I've never seen anything so deliberately. Mm-hmm. Let's just say the FDA really screwed that one up, because if ever there was an instance where they deliberately just threw out a PMTA because they knew it was politically necessary, it would have been Juul. Just to get everyone off their back.
They did that with 99% of them. Yeah. They didn't look at the science.
Well, on this particular occasion, they didn't even bother.
Well, Juul had more studies than they were even asked for. Juul had that's crazy amount of stuff.
They said we didn't get this test, and these pods leaked, and it was the most ridiculous excuses, and it was just right there for the least. Less.
Yeah, I'm waiting for them to say, "Oh, I'm sorry, my dog ate it." Yeah,
people that knew nothing about Juul and nothing about the FDA, nothing about vaping could look at that and say, like, oh, that's bullshit.
We have to look at the reality. You know, the disposables. I don't think any of them will ever get a marketing order, and here's why. It's the environmental assessment, because these things are an environmental hazard when you throw them away.
There's a fix for that that we could work on. There's already completely disposable vapes in Dubai. Possible. It's just we can't focus on doing things that need to be done for the environment because we're too focused on trying to just stay alive.
It's just
exactly. If you just approve our stuff, then we can start working on something that's more environmentally friendly.
More importantly,
us so worried about doing anything because we already know that it's going to get denied. Yeah.
Well, and that's one of the arguments I made last week is they were talking about the disposables. And I said, well, do you understand why the disposables are even on the market? No, they didn't know. I go, the disposables are on the market because FDA banned in early 2020, they banned the flavored pods. And at the time, synthetic nicotine was not regulated. And so guess what? This filled the gap.
Yeah, but in the meantime, this has become something that is critical to keep on the market because people like my 82-year-old neighbor will go back to smoking cigarettes if she cannot get a disposable. She's already told me that. So
I'm pretty sure. Right. Filtered cigarette butts are not 100%.
Filtered cigarette butts are still one of the top contributors to pollution. And sorry, but all the toxins that are inside that seeps into the water make it toxic.
We can talk about product substitution on the environmental assessment, right?
Guess what? The cigarettes, they don't got to go through the process to show the environmental lack of environmental harm for their products. Because guess what? They're grandfathered.
Yeah, right. But I mean, I've seen new vapes coming out that are much more environmentally friendly. It is possible. And I feel like if we were allowed to be innovative, we could create something that fits both of those things, is better for the environment, and helps keep a lot of these older people, which is what I see, absolutely, using disposables, because they are intimidated by a vaping device. And I've tried, she's been on this thing for over a year now, and I've tried a pod system. I've tried the simplest pod system I could find. Nope, don't want it. I don't want to do any of that liquid stuff. Like, this is just how some people are. So she doesn't get to have harm reduction because they don't like disposables, and that's the new target.
Yeah.
I got to go. I keep talking. I got to go refill my glass.
You're good.
Uh-oh. He's got to refill that gin and tonic.
No.
No.
Actually, it's Kroger brand Diet Cherry Cola.
Yeah.
After giving my mother open systems for the last 12 years, finally, she's actually using this half as much as she spoke. She's smoking half as much as she once did.
Yeah.
And it's taken that much. So what I think Ali is right. And that's what pisses me off so much about Reynolds and Ultra right now. Instead of actually investing in innovation, what they're doing is they're investing in clearing out the competition, which is fucking
up. Right. And they keep saying that none of these disposables are illegal, but guess what? I'm pretty sure Greg Conley read off all of the STN numbers at the Wisconsin hearing, or a few of them, for accepted PMTA applications for Elf Bar and Lost Mary and a few others that they have on this list in this fraudulent paperwork that they're passing out to lawmakers about what is, you know, what these disposables are, and saying, oh, they're made in China. Well, guess what? I got a Views the other day, and guess what it says right on the back of it? It's made in China. Mm-hmm. So where are we at?
Is this the same, like, you know, composite, you know, profile of disposables that contains the whole fentanyl possibility? Because that was fun. The whole, like, oh, they might have fentanyl in it.
That kind of, like, came in and out because everybody was like, this is the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard in my entire life. Like,
it could come from the Chernobyl region. And has that been tested?
The Chernobyl region.
I don't know. It's still saying the groundwater there is polluted. Damn it. Everybody needs to, like, stop and think about the groundwater. I'm like, what the hell is wrong with you?
You may grow an extra nipple.
It's just I get so frustrated because God only knows what they're gonna say next, and I don't have the ability to comprehend this.
Yeah, I'm still waiting to see what the next side effect is. I mean, they got hair, they got erections. What else did they have? They attacked
for teeth. Vaping?
Yeah, teeth. I mean,
Nick Orlando's in Mr. has entered Orlando. The
we talked about, you at the Nick. Beginning of the show, buddy.
Win the day as you did. Well done.
Nothing is being made anymore with Elf Bar. That is a not a real product. It has all been moved over to EB Create or EB Design or whatever the newest name is. And that name was a trademark issue, and they had to change it. So if you see anything, this is Elf Bar. It's either super old or it is.
Yeah. No, actually, I know a little bit about that because I'm involved in that litigation. Elf Bar and EB are two different companies. Elf Bar is made by VPR Brands, and EB is made by iMiracle, Shenzhen iMiracle. I'm involved in trademark litigation in Savannah, Georgia, between iMiracle. What happened was I represent a vape shop owner, got a chain of stores in Georgia, and he got sued by VPR. The Elf Bar, and they've got this injunction in Florida. There's a dispute in Florida over the trademark. So VPR, who's got the injunction, sues my client in in Georgia, claiming they're infringing on the mark. Well, that gives me the right to challenge their trademark as a counterclaim. And this lawyer called me up. This is last spring. Calls me up and just is, you know, like, I'm gonna fuck your clients up and whatever. And I'm thinking, you idiot. You have no idea the contacts I've got in this industry. And so I didn't argue with him. I just said, okay, got to do what you got to do. Got off the phone with him, picked up the phone, called Eric Heyer at Thompson Hine, who represents iMiracle, and said, Eric, I just had a really interesting conversation. Eric goes, you want to have some fun? I go, yeah, I'm always game for fun. He goes, you got to find a way to get iMiracle brought into the case in Georgia. And I says, how's the UCC breach of warranty claim sound? He goes, perfect. I filed an answer and got local counsel, filed an answer and counterclaim in federal court in Georgia. And Eric sent me all the materials from Florida. So I replicated what he had done down there and challenged VPR's trademark, Elf trademark. And they did some really shady stuff. Indeed. And then I filed a third party claim against iMiracle and Demand Vape, who was the distributor and the manufacturer of the bars that my client was selling, that they breached the Georgia UCC warranty, a breach of warranty. And iMiracle then did a third party claim back against VPR challenging their trademark. So VPR's filed this lawsuit that they think that they're just bringing a garden variety infringement suit. And they unleashed nuclear war. You remember the movie War Games, you know, where it shows the map of all the things going off? That's what happened.
Yeah.
Global thermonuclear.
Elf Bar is made by, or the BC5000 or 7500 or whatever. Those are made by VPR brands.
And well, then the EB Create is also a BC5000.
Yeah, right. EB is from the iMiracle. They had to rebrand.
Isn't Funky Republic also the same?
Lost Mary.
Lost Mary as well.
I just put it in the chat. So EB Create, Lost Mary, Funky Republic, and Geek Bar all have STM numbers. They've all have PMTAs, and they have all been accepted by the FDA.
And say what you want about Elf Bar. It's one of the best disposables ever, period, when they were able to operate. That all that being said, I think that the disposables that I see on the shelves in vape stores these days are all reliably good. They're all, you know, up to scratch in terms of, you know, quality control. And that's something I've been doing religiously for the last 8 months, is buying whatever, you know, my friends have new in stock, just so I can do my own personal assessment of what it is and why anyone should or should not buy it. And I have to be honest with you. Yeah. If you go to some, you know, Merle's Bait and Tackle out in the middle of, you know, outside of Talladega, that's, you know, it's probably not going to be the same quality, and nor should you buy. You should buy bait there, not, you know, a disposable. But what I'm seeing at vape shops is quality product made by a lot of the companies we see open systems from. Go ahead.
Exactly. What you get, and this is what I tried to explain to the legislators, is that if you're worried about the stuff coming in from China with what you don't know what's in it, that's not going to be found in a vape shop, because the vape shop owners are literally the last line of defense.
Yeah. When is it? We have like 8 minutes, and I'm going to have some fun with you, because you have answered all our questions on the other thing. So I'm going to hit you with some would you rather questions. Greg, are you ready? You can say yes. You ready, Craig?
Okay.
He's having a petty mouth seizure.
Was I?
I'm there ready. You go.
There's your,
let's do it.
There's your first one.
Okay, let me pull it up here.
Oh, he can't see it. I can barely see it. Somebody read it.
I will read it. Would you rather be trapped in a cage with a tame tiger or be trapped with a rabid squirrel?
I was having to think about this earlier today.
This reminds me of the warning my parents used to always give me. This reminds me of the warning my parents used to always give me when I would go out in the ocean. Be careful for the sharks. And I'm like, guys, sharks aren't going to bother me. Professional courtesy. I'd rather be
God, that's so bad, counsel.
is that like someone asks you if you're a good lawyer? You go, yeah, I'm really good. I get a sodomy charge reduced to follow me too close.
What?
That's a bad thing. Trapped with a rabid squirrel. Can I bring my Hillock and Bradsby with me?
Is that a crossbow?
No. No, Hillary and Bradsby's a Louisville slugger. If I can bring my Louisville slugger with me, I'm good with the rabid squirrel, because I'll take care of the rabid squirrel. It'll be batter up.
Yeah. I have a little hand pellet gun in a lockbox. I lost the key, though. It's been in there for a long time. I'm just going to throw it away.
Would you rather charge your phone once a week or not have a camera on your phone?
The camera comes in handy. And the camera comes in handy for a lot of reasons. You know, you may be out, I may be out, and I need to gather evidence of something. That phone is, that camera is vital.
I agree. I have a question. I have questions.
All right, go, Timmy.
Will your phone be dead for 6 days?
I knew he was going to ask that.
I've got an iPhone 11 Pro that I bought in August of 2020. My battery is like at 75% efficiency. So I've got to charge it multiple times a day.
All right. Really? All right. The last one. This one should be funny. Would you rather wear someone else's dirty underwear or use their toothbrush?
Ooh.
Well, first off, counsel, I object. That assumes facts, not in evidence. That assumes that I wear underwear.
Well played. Well played.
It assumes that I brush my teeth. Actually, I would rather use their toothbrush.
I would like to apologize for our viewers and listeners at this point. We are just kidding. We all brush our teeth, floss.
Actually, the toothbrush would be the preferred one. Because what I'm going to do is I'm going to disinfect it in hydrogen peroxide before I use it.
There you go.
That's spoken like a true man of the legal profession. Well done. Okay.
Work counsel, around. Approach the bench. Counsel, please approach the bench.
Yeah.
Anything anybody else has to throw out there?
No, I just want to say I wish Greg all the luck in the world with all of these fights he's up against. You're a gentleman and a scholar and a true warrior to get up there and fight for the sake of this community and the sake of health and the sake of people improving their lives. So,
what a lot of people may not know is I never smoked and I don't vape, but I do believe you're on the right side of this.
Well, and that's why your impression means so much more, because we know as vapers, we know we've made the right choice. It's like we say, it's about convincing people who don't really have a dog in the fight that we're on the right side of all of this. And we're helping people to see the obvious sham that we're being subjected to.
Counselor,
that's one of the things is by training, we're trained to fight for people who can't fight for themselves. That's what an advocate is. It's what a lawyer is, an advocate.
Yep.
We're trained to run to danger. We're trained to run it. We're like the first responders. We run into burning buildings. We put ourselves on the line out there. We put our reputations on the line every time we take a case on.
Yeah.
No. I wouldn't be involved in this if I didn't think you all were right. And I didn't think you were getting screwed.
Yep. That's what I was going to say. As long as you believe in the cause.
Absolutely. And I think I speak for Eric Heyer. I think I speak for Azeem, Eric Godding, the other industry attorneys. We believe in this, and we believe you're getting screwed, and we believe there's something we can do about it. Because we think we're on the right side of history, and we think that at the end of the day, we're going to help make history. We're going to help rewrite history.
If I may.
Amen to that.
Counselor, I know I give you a hard time, but I think it's because we've been – the first time you and I ever made contact was on Facebook, back when I used Facebook. You wrote some of the more intelligent responses to idiotic posts about vaping, and I've always thought of that moment that I met you in DC in 2019. And I give you a hard time because I respect you very much for all the time that you spend sometimes pro bono helping people understand this situation, which is, as I'm sure you can attest, convoluted would be a very mild way to put it. And I just want to say thank you sincerely for all your efforts and for doing what you do and doing it because you know it's the right thing.
Well, I appreciate that, Philip. And we've just got to hang in and fight this. We are so close. And I know I've had this discussion with people in the industry. They're exhausted. I know our friend Nick is absolutely worn out right now. But look at who are the best fighters. The best fighters are the ones that are worn out or tired and just don't give a damn. And they say, we're, you know, we've got nothing to lose.
Yep.
And right now we've got nothing to lose. Because if we do nothing, you know how it's going to end.
Mm-hmm.
And the most dangerous opponent is an opponent who's got their back against the wall and they've got nothing to lose.
Yeah, I'm with you.
And I honestly think the tide has turned. And I think the tide started turning when Triton came out. I can tell you, I was at the Keller Heckman Symposium, Azeem's firm symposium in Vegas, right before a couple days before TPE. The vibe, and I've been at those for like 6 or 7 years. The vibe was incredible among everybody there. Everybody was excited. The presenters were excited. The people that were there were excited. We had a lot of fun talking ideas, sharing ideas during the downtime. I got some really good time with Derek Yock from the used to be the World Health Organization. If you've seen A Billion Lives.
Amazing guy. Yeah.
When he found out that I had done briefs in the Loper case, the Chevron case, he talked to me. He says, I want to try to get you on the schedule to come up to New York in September and speak to the Harvard Club. Do you know what kind of people that gets us in front of?
Yeah.
The kind of people who don't really look at the pragmatism.
I knew that was coming.
No, these are people like Wall Street people, financial people.
Yeah.
Okay. These are movers and shakers.
So that's a euphemism for people that are well connected and wealthy, and that's that.
Right. Okay. They've got FU money.
Yeah. They went to Harvard. Eric, guys, we're at the 2-hour mark. I want to thank Greg for joining us. It's quick, man. It happens fast when we're having fun.
I have an uncle in the heart. Anyway, continue. Sorry. I wasn't thinking.
Oh, you always make me lose my train of thought, Philip.
Sorry, no.
When I see Philip, it's gone to the point. When I see Philip, I go right to "You look marvelous." In my head, I'm already saying "You look marvelous."
And for once, you know, I look marvelous, but less marvelous than I have in the past. Flu really knocks the shit out of you.
You are the Taylor Swift to me. Where if I see Taylor, I go shake it off. It's the first thing that pops in my head. When I see you, it's like, you look marvelous, Donald. I mean, you look marvelous.
I love you, Greg. All. Good night.
Thanks for joining us. Always fun having you on here. Like I said at the beginning, I having my friend say that, you are a lawyer that explains everything in detail and easy to understand. And that's awesome. That's why we have you on the show. Thank you, Tim, Allie, Philip. And everybody, look in the camera. Let me make sure I get this right. Wait, that's wrong. Take that off there. I'm never prepared. Everybody look in the camera and say goodbye.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.